film will concern itself with the chemistry of ammonia, NH3, and its solutions in water, known as ammonia water or ammonium hydroxide solution. We will study the laboratory preparation of ammonia gas, its reactions under several different circumstances, and also the reactions of its solution in water. In the course of our experiments on ammonia, we will need to identify the gas from time to time, and therefore we need to develop a quick test for its presence. Ammonia dissolves in water to give solutions which are rather weakly basic. And therefore, the most convenient and most rapid test for the presence of ammonia depends on this property, since ammonia is the only common gas encountered in the inorganic laboratory, which is basic. In this tube, we have some distilled water containing a drop of methyl red indicator. And in this tube, water containing some phenolphthalein indicator. To this tube also, I've added one drop of hydrochloric acid so that the indicator is now exhibiting its red or acid color. Now to each tube, I'll add a few milliliters of ammonia water or ammonium hydroxide. You should notice that the methyl red indicator changed from red to yellow, and the phenolphthalein indicator changed from colorless to its characteristic pinkish red color in basic solution. Now, either of these indicators can be used to test for the presence of ammonia, and we will use them from time to time in the course of the forthcoming experiments. Ammonia gas can be conveniently generated in the laboratory from ammonium salts or solutions of ammonium salts and strong bases such as sodium hydroxide. The hydroxide ion reacts with the ammonium ion with the production of water and NH3, which can be expelled from the solution. In this test tube, I've placed about this much ammonium chloride solution and about this much sodium hydroxide solution. In this tube, we have some distilled water containing phenolphthalein. Any evolved gas will pass through the delivery tube and down near the surface of this solution. And since ammonia is soluble in water, if any ammonia is formed, it will dissolve in the solution, producing a color change. We will now heat the contents of the large test tube and observe what happens in the small test tube. The mixture of ammonium chloride and sodium hydroxide is boiling in the large tube. The gas is passing over. This gas is a mixture of water vapor and ammonia. The water vapor condenses in the cold tube, producing the liquid that you see. But it's obvious that ammonia is being evolved from the solution also, because it has colored the phenolphthalein in the small test tube a bright pink-red color, characteristic of this indicator in solutions of ammonia in water. It's also possible to generate ammonia from a solid ammonium salt and a solid base. In the test tube, we've placed a mixture of ammonium sulfate and calcium hydroxide, both solids, which have been ground together in the small mortar. We'll now heat these two salts, and again observe the reaction of the evolved gas with the phenolphthalein solution in the small test tube. We're now heating the mixture of the solid ammonium sulfate and calcium hydroxide, and the produced gases are being liberated near the surface of the phenolphthalein solution in the tube which you see. I'll now insert a stirring rod and mix. It's obvious that ammonia gas has been evolved, dissolved in the water, and change the color of the phenolphthalein indicator. We tested solutions of ammonium hydroxide with methyl red indicator and with phenolphthalein, and we found that they tested basic. Now, the cause for this test was the hydroxide ion. And it used to be thought that the hydroxide ion was produced by the dissociation of the molecule of ammonium hydroxide. More recently, however, chemists have decided that there is really little evidence for the existence of this molecule at all, and that this equation is preferred. This shows the molecule of ammonia reacting with water reversibly to form some ammonium ions and some hydroxide ions. The practice of referring to solutions of ammonia in water as ammonium hydroxide still persists, however, even though this equation is probably the more accurate representation of what is taking place. In any case, the hydroxide ion is present and causes solutions of ammonia to act as a base. We then found that when we reacted ammonium chloride solutions with sodium hydroxide solutions, ammonia was liberated, and the other products of the reaction were water and sodium chloride. And then we found that when solid ammonium sulfate was heated with calcium hydroxide, again, ammonia was liberated along with water, and calcium sulfate remained in the tube. We are now utilizing the principles illustrated in the preceding experiment for the production of ammonia gas in some quantity for laboratory use. In the flask, we placed a mixture of ammonium sulfate and calcium hydroxide. We're heating this with the Bunsen burner. NH3 will be evolved, pass through this glass tube up into the bottle. Since ammonia is considerably lighter than air, having a weight of 17 on the scale where air is about 29, we're collecting this gas by the downward displacement of air. We'll collect several bottles of ammonia in this way, and then use them to examine several different chemical properties of ammonia. Previously, the statement has been made that ammonia is quite soluble in water. To illustrate this point, I'll place a bottle of the ammonia that we've just collected in this beaker. The water in the beaker contains some phenolphthalein that we've added. You see that the water is rapidly rising in the bottle, indicating the speed with which ammonia dissolved. You see also that this water has turned red, once again indicating ammonia's properties as a base. Next, we will test the ability of ammonia to burn in air and to support combustion. The bottle contains ammonia, which we produced from our generator. With this splint, I'll invert the bottle, bring the splint to the mouth. You notice that nothing much seems to happen. When the splint is lowered into the bottle, it is extinguished. This test indicates that ammonia does not burn in air and that it does not support combustion. The bottle on the stand contains ammonia, which we prepared in our generator. In another bottle, I have pure oxygen gas. I'll invert the ammonia bottle and place the bottle of oxygen mouth to mouth with it. We'll permit the bottles to stand in this position for several minutes, and we'll then attempt to light the mixture. We'll now remove the top bottle and attempt to light the gas in the bottom bottle. We'll now attempt to light the gas in the top bottle. Both times, a puff of flame was obtained, indicating that while ammonia won't burn in air, it will burn in a mixture of ammonia and oxygen. The gases that are produced are water vapor and nitrogen. A characteristic reaction of ammonia is its reaction with hydrogen chloride to produce the salt ammonium chloride. In this bottle, we have some ammonia, which we made with our generator. On this filter paper, I've placed several drops of a solution of concentrated hydrochloric acid. I'll now drop the filter paper with the acid on it into the bottle of ammonia. You see that the bottle rapidly fills with dense white fumes of ammonium chloride. The ammonia we produced in our generator was tested with a flaming splint, and we found that the ammonia neither burned nor supported combustion under the conditions of this experiment. This indicates that ammonia and oxygen, then, do not react under these conditions. A mixture of ammonia and pure oxygen can be made to react with the production of nitrogen, and at higher temperatures, these elements react with the formation of nitric oxide. Our result, though, is the one obtained at essentially room temperature with air as a source of oxygen. We can say that a mixture of hydrochloric acid vapors and ammonia react rapidly and vigorously with the production of ammonium chloride salt. We will now examine the use of a solution of ammonia in water, or ammonium hydroxide, as a precipitating agent. In the two test tubes, I've placed small samples of magnesium chloride solution and ferric chloride solution, which I've diluted with a few milliliters of distilled water. We'll now add a small quantity of ammonium hydroxide solution to each tube and examine the results. In each tube, a precipitate has appeared. In the tube on the left, we have the white precipitate of magnesium hydroxide, and in the tube on the right, the reddish-brown precipitate of ferric hydroxide. Obviously, then, ammonia water contains a sufficient concentration of hydroxide ion so that the solubility products of both magnesium hydroxide and ferric hydroxide have been exceeded. Before, we saw that the addition of ammonia water to solutions of ferric chloride and magnesium chloride caused a precipitate of the respective hydroxides to be obtained in each case. Now, in the two test tubes, we've again placed solutions of magnesium chloride and ferric chloride. This time, however, to each tube, I'm going to add a rather large amount of ammonium chloride solution. And then proceed to add some ammonium hydroxide. And you'll notice an immediate difference in the appearance of the material in the two tubes. Ferric hydroxide is still precipitated by the ammonia water. We can see the copious precipitate here, while magnesium hydroxide is not obtained in this case. This result is obtained because the presence of large amounts of ammonium ion from the ammonium chloride repressed the ionization of the ammonium hydroxide and greatly reduced the concentration of hydroxide ion. When we added a solution of ammonia water to solutions of magnesium chloride and ferric chloride, the precipitate of the hydroxides was obtained in each case, because the concentration of hydroxide ion produced by the ionization of the ammonia gave us sufficient hydroxide ion concentration to cause the product of the magnesium ion and the hydroxide ion squared to exceed the solubility product for magnesium hydroxide and similarly for ferric hydroxide. And precipitates of these two hydroxides were obtained. When ammonium chloride was present in the solution, this high concentration of ammonium ion due to the ammonium chloride caused this equilibrium to reverse to the left and made the concentration of hydroxide ion very small. And this smaller concentration of hydroxide ion, when squared and multiplied by the magnesium ion, must now have been less than the solubility product for magnesium hydroxide because no precipitate was obtained. However, ferric hydroxide is so insoluble, or its solubility product constant is so small that even the greatly reduced hydroxide ion concentration present when cubed and multiplied by the ferric ion concentration, exceeded the solubility product constant for ferric hydroxide. We've seen that ammonium chloride, ammonia water mixtures, then, can be used to separate mixtures of the magnesium ion and the ferric ion, because the magnesium ion will remain in solution while the ferric ion will be precipitated out as the hydroxide. This experiment also illustrates that these insoluble hydroxides, such as magnesium hydroxide and ferric hydroxide, still differ greatly in their solubility, because we've demonstrated here that magnesium hydroxide must be considerably more soluble than ferric hydroxide. Finally, in our study of ammonia water as a precipitant, we'll examine its reaction with copper sulfate solution. In the test tube, I placed about 1 milliliter of copper sulfate solution and about 5 milliliters of water. And to this solution, I'm going to add ammonium hydroxide or ammonia water dropwise. You'll see that the first drop of ammonium hydroxide causes the formation of a whitish precipitate. This is copper hydroxide. With additional drops of ammonia water, more and more precipitate is obtained. Now, as we continue to add ammonia water, you'll notice that the precipitate in this region of the tube is disappearing, and the deep blue color, which is characteristic of the copper ammonia complex ion, is appearing. In the tube, we now have a mixture of copper hydroxide and some copper ammonia complex ion. And by adding several more drops of ammonia water, we can cause all of the precipitate to dissolve, which it has now done. We see, therefore, that when ammonium hydroxide is added to copper sulfate solutions, a precipitate of copper hydroxide is first obtained, and then as more ammonia is added, this precipitate dissolves. We'll examine the equations for this reaction in the next sequence. When we added dropwise ammonia water to solution containing the copper ion, we found that the first thing that happened was that we obtained a precipitate of copper hydroxide. This precipitate was formed because of the hydroxide ions produced by the ammonia water reacting with the copper ion, forming copper hydroxide. And this occurred because the concentration of copper ion times hydroxide ion squared was greater than the solubility product constant for copper hydroxide. This was a situation when we added just a few drops of ammonia water. You should bear in mind that some copper ions are always present in solution in equilibrium with the copper hydroxide precipitate. Then we added considerably more ammonia water. And when this was done, the ammonia molecules present reacted with those few copper ions which were in equilibrium with the precipitate, converting these copper ions to the copper ammonia complex ion. Now, as copper ions were removed from this equilibrium and converted to the copper ammonia complex, the precipitate of copper hydroxide dissolved because the copper ion concentration became so small that now this reduced copper ion concentration times the hydroxide ion concentration squared was less than the solubility product for copper hydroxide. And by adding a sufficient quantity of ammonia water, we eventually converted nearly all of the copper ions to copper ammonia complex ions and dissolve the precipitate completely.